What I like about the Tarc Ambassador Program is that this is an opportunity for the participant and their family to take part in a great adventure to where they can tell their story. That story can also help another family that may be in a situation where they're not sure what direction am I going in, am I making the right choices, and they can actually see these ambassadors being successful and that the family can reach out to other families. Our new baby ambassador this year, we're very excited about, and actually we could say practically a newborn. His parents are very involved, and one of the things that they shared with us is that they're very excited about being a part of Tarc and the ambassadorship. They want to share their story. They want to share with other young couples.
So going through our pregnancy with Dr. Ashford, man, being a new dad, I don't know anything about pregnancy. I don't know nothing. I always had a ton of questions for him, and I would ask him those tons of questions, and he'd always make fun of me. You got any more questions before you leave for the day? Because I wasn't always able to go to the doctor's visits. So, my wife would go to the visits, and when I wasn't there, I'd ask her a million questions, and it got to be where everything's fine, don't worry. So, I'd have to say around 6 months or so, I'm just like, are you sure you're pregnant? I said, because your stomach just really isn't showing too much. So we didn't think much of it. And then, her maternal instincts kind of kicked in, I guess, around 33 weeks or so. And she said, I should be a lot bigger. Something doesn't feel right. Let me ask Dr. Ashford for an ultrasound.
So during my pregnancy, everything was going really well. I was extremely healthy. I was shockingly healthy for always being sick. So a few weeks before I was due, I started having some symptoms, and I had an ultrasound, and he was on the smaller side, and so they diagnosed me with IUGR, which is intrauterine growth restriction. So at that point, they were really closely monitoring me, which, IUGR has no association with Down syndrome. So whenever we went in, the ultrasound showed that he was losing weight and that I was leaking fluids, and so they immediately sent me over to have him. It was a pretty rough labor, but whenever I finally had him, they threw him on my chest for maybe 5 seconds, and then they just took him away. In that little 5 seconds, I kind of saw him, and obviously you're a mother for the first time, you're overcome with joy, you're just happy that, he's out, he's in the world, he's breathing, he's screaming, crying, it's great. And then, they kind of just took him away. And so it was like, we didn't know what was wrong. We thought everything had to pertain to the IUGR and him being premature. Prior to us going into the NICU though, the neonatologist came in, and they came in and said, in front of everyone, that he had Down syndrome or characteristics of Down syndrome, but that we wouldn't know for sure until results from Tulane came back. So, at that point, obviously, it's like you're happy that you had your baby, but it's like the joy is just almost sucked out of you.
When the doctor said that we think your baby has symptoms of being a Down syndrome baby, it's just like, wow. How do you take that? What do you think? Because, you don't want to think ill will, like, why did this happen to me, or, anything like that. But at the same time, it's just a big shock because you're not prepared for it.
It almost felt guilty in a sense whenever I got that news that I just wasn't still overcome with joy, for having him. I guess that after we announced it, I had a parent of a Down syndrome child who actually her daughter used to be a Tarc ambassador. And so she messaged me, and what she said really, really stuck. And it made me feel 100 times better. And it's hard to explain to people who this process and this, situation, they don't have to deal with it. But she messaged me, and what she said was, it's okay to grieve the child that you thought you were gonna have. That made me feel 10 times better because it was like, I do love him, he's my son, but it's just so much to take in at once, so.
Now you gotta start thinking about, the future, if he'll be able to be on his own, if he'll be able to interact with others, if he'll have his friends. And the life expectancy of a Down syndrome baby is 40 to 60 years. So, there's not many people out there, that will have to bury their son, and that's one thing that me and my wife will have to do. And no matter how prepared you are for that, it's not easy. It's not an easy thing to do. Not many parents have to go through it.
You're gonna have days where, you just think, why did God put me in these shoes and why us? You know, you just think that you're gonna have a perfectly healthy child, and then, you know, you have to overcome all these obstacles as a team. And, you know, if you weren't a team before, get ready because you're about to be a team, you know? And I guess that you overcome it, but you have bad days, and it's okay to have bad days, but don't let that, you know, don't give yourself a pity party all the time, and that it's gonna be okay. And I mean, obviously right now, Grady is only 7 weeks, so he can't really, you know, communicate with us too much, but I know once he starts, you know, walking and talking, he's just gonna have a huge personality, and he's gonna make us laugh and smile more than we ever could have imagined.
You know, there's nothing that anyone else can say, really, to be honest, that will make you feel better about it at the time or throughout the course of your life with your son or daughter. But, you know, step up. You know, there's a lot of things that could be worse. You know, everybody hopes for the best, but God doesn't give anything to you that you can't handle. And I'm a firm believer that God puts you in situations and down the path that you need to be because it's His will. So look at it from that point of view, you know, pray about it, or if, even if you're not really a big religious person, go talk to your friends or seek out a therapist if you're having a hard time dealing with it, something like that. But there are resources out there that are able to help you go through something like this.
We're really happy to represent Tarc. You know, it's such a great way to promote these children and these adults with disabilities, and it's a great way to raise money.
Because, you know, I go back to my days at LaRondra Elementary and even up through LaRondra High School and doing the Penny Power. You know, I used to think how great it was to be able to help kids like that. So, you know, I was really big, and I was always aggravating my parents, you know, give me more pennies, let me donate, let me give back, you know. So it's really nice, you know, to be a representative of that, something that I did, you know, did care about, you know, giving back to the community or giving to people who needed help. Because, you know, there are parents out here who can't afford, you know, some of the treatments or can't, you know, do necessarily get that help. And, you know, with the money being raised, that's what it goes towards. It goes towards helping these families who need that extra help, who can't afford it or whatever have you. So I think it's really great that we were selected to do this, and it's an honor.
This year, Mr. Roy is our adult ambassador. This individual has a very loving and involved family. Whenever it comes to making sure that Mr. Roy and all of his needs are met, his family is right there. Mr. Roy is always happy, easygoing, willing to do whatever there is to do. His personality reaches out to the other clients because he's always so happy. And his cheerful personality carries on to our other staff and our participants.
My name is Roy Nathaniel Sand Jr. of Hamlin, Louisiana. I'm both 16, 1958, and I'm 59.
He was always a lovable person, good to get along with. He always looked after us. He went to school and completed his 12th grade year. And then after the 12th grade year, he started having behavior problems. So then that's when they diagnosed him with the bipolar schizophrenic with mild mental retardation.
It was kind of rough because that's when the behaviors start occurring. He had mood swings. I think that's a part of it. A lot of mood swings. He was happy one day, mad one day, sad one day. The medicines kind of controlled it at one point, and then on the end it didn't.
Later he went on to options to work, where he was classified as a high level client, and he had a job. He worked at Hammond High, cleaning up building there. He worked at Whitehall on Southeastern campus before his sickness. Back in 2015, he developed to have behavior problems again, and he went through 4 different hospitals to try to find out what was going on, and they could not determine what was wrong with him. He was gonna be discharged home, and they gave him a shot. And once they gave him the shot, he went into AFib, and he pulled his catheter out. So he stayed in ICU for 9 days. He stayed in the hospital for probably 2.5 months, and they sent him home. with hospice, saying that, that there was nothing else that they could do for him. At that time, Roy wasn't able to speak. He wasn't able to walk. He wasn't able to talk. He ended up coming home with a peg tube. He was discharged from the hospital February the 19th. They had basically just given up on him.
He's better today, but it took some working, you know, because they didn't think he was going to be here. He was so messed up with all those different medications that they was trying on him. Let's try this. Let's try this new med. Let's try that new med. So he had to learn how to do everything all over again.
God is able. God is good. He's talking. He's walking. He's eating. He's back up to his normal weight.
Once he got out, he was at CARE. But CARE, when he got sick, they didn't want to staff Roy because they felt that he was too sick to staff him. So that's how we end up with Veronica. She said, Tarc, won't you try Tarc? Just come over there and visit with Tarc. So I did. And it just was a better atmosphere. So I came back and I talked with Roy. Veronica talked with Roy and asked him would he like to come to Tarc. So we end up switching agencies. And from there, he started going to Tarc Dayhab twice a week, Tuesdays and Thursdays. I asked him how do he like it. He said he loved it. They go on different outings. And from there, he started going 5 days a week. He's happy. He's back to the happy Roy.
It's okay. I enjoy Tarc.